Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dear students, Assalamu alaikum. I am Dr. Atika Masood. Today we are going to discuss about the metastasis in the neoplasias. And as you all know, whenever we are no longer checking about the cell checkpoints, the cancer cells are growing rapidly because of the loss of the cell cycle checkpoints, and because of there is no check, they are going to proliferate, they are going to invade, and they are going to metastasize. So the learning objectives of today's lecture, as you can all see in this picture, that these cells are talking about and finding their way towards the brain and the other metastatic routes. So from where they are going to go to the different or to the distant sites. So our learning objective is, at the end of this lecture, students will be able to enlist and describe the routes of spreads of the tumor. The students will be able to describe the metastatic cascade stepwise. So here is an MCQ for you people. The biopsies were performed on the patients who had palpable mass lesion on the digital rectal examination. So my dear students, the most important thing is there is a palpable mass, and this palpable mass has undergone the biopsies. And what we are going to see in this, which one of the following microscopic findings? So they are asking about the microscopic findings that is most likely to indicate that the neoplasm is malignant. So they are asking you that these, you have to tell them that which are these qualities which make this palpable masses a malignant masses. So your option A is pleomorphism, option B is atypia, C is invasion, D is increased nuclear to cytoplasmic ratio, and E is necrosis. I hope it will be very easy for you, because today we are discussing the invasion, we are discussing the metastasis. So it will be easy for you to judge that this is the only thing that the malignant tumors are going to show. So as you all know that the characteristics of the benign and the malignant tumor that we have already discussed are differentiation and anaplasia. As you all know from my previous lecture that benign tumors are very much well differentiated, while the malignant ones are the least differentiated, and they are showing the characteristics of the anaplasia. And all you know that anaplasia is to move backward. So the rate of growth in the malignant tumor is very fast, while the rate of growth in the benign tumors is very slow. As far as local invasion is concerned, the benign tumors are not going to invade the locally, but the malignant ones are going to cause the local invasion. And the most important and the thing that we are going to discuss today is the metastasis. So this is the most important characteristic of all the malignant tumors, and that is metastasis. I think now it is very easy for you to guess the MCQ, okay, what will be the right option. So what is the metastasis? The metastasis is the development of the secondary implants. So where are the primary implants? The primary implants are there in the primary tumor sites. So, but these secondary implants are discontinuous with those of the primary tumors in the remote tissue. So it's very easy to understand that if primary tumor is in liver, then the secondary implants you could see in the bones, in the joint, in the bones, and you could see in the lungs. So secondary are far, far, far away from the primary ones, and there is a discontinuity. So properties of the invasiveness and the metastasis is going to identify the neoplasm as the malignant. So these are the most important thing. Again, I'm telling you, I have given you many options, and I have told you rate of growth, about the capsulation, about invasion, about other things. But the most important thing, you just have to remember that malignant is always invasive, malignant is going to metastasize. So variable metastatic capabilities, and some are diagnosed when they are going to be metastasized in the far away areas, and it is very unfortunate. So malignant neoplasms are going to disseminate by three routes. One is by the direct spread or the seedling within the body cavities, and we have already discussed about the peritoneal cavities, about the pericardial activities, pleural cavities, and then there is a lymphatic spread and the hematogenous spread. I have told you last time that lymphatic spread is basically mainly for the carcinomas, while the hematogenous spread is for the sarcomas, but exceptions are always there. As far as we are going to discuss about the metastatic cascade, the metastatic cascade can be subdivided into two phases. The one is the invasion of the extracellular matrix. So wherever this tumor is there, it has to invade the ECM matrix or extracellular matrix, and then it is going to go into the vessels for the dissemination. So first is invasion, second is the vascular dissemination. And why these vessels? It is going to go some other place, which is at secondary site. So at the secondary site, it is going to cause the homing of the tumor cells. So these tumor cells are going to make an other home at the secondary site. So this is a diagram from your book. As you can all see, student, as you see, these green cells are very, very good cells, benign looking cells. And if you see, these are becoming the tumorous, and their NC ratio is slightly going to be disturbed here again and here again, and these tumorous cells are going to cause the clonal expansion, and there will be the growth. And as you see, there are vessels here. If I'm going to draw these vessels are needed because of the clonal expansion. They need nutrition, they need growth, for the growth, the oxygen. So these vessels are going to give them oxygen, they are going to give them food for their growth. So, and these cells are going to cause the diversification. When this metastatic clone is rapidly growing, the most important thing that we are going to discuss is that they are going to separate from each other. So one cell, one cell which is malignant one, is going to separate from the other, and the most important thing is the loss of the E-cadherin, and we are going to discuss this phenomena in whole detail, that why E-cadherin is lost, and when E-cadherin is lost, what is the second most important thing that is going to come and play its role. So after there is a losing of the junctions between the cells and there is a loss of the E-cadherin, the cells are ready to be separated out from this colon, and they are going to invade the extracellular matrix, which is the first thing. So before invading the extracellular matrix, they are going to cause the adhesion, and then they are going to invade. So what things they need for the invasion? As you all know, that for the degradation of the extracellular matrix, we need ACEs, proteases, we need cathepsinases, we need collagenases. So we are going to discuss all these in detail, that these ACEs are going to help in the degradation, like matrix metalloproteinases, and these matrix metalloproteinases are going to cause the degradation of this extracellular matrix. Once this is going to be going into the extracellular matrix, there will be the intravasation within the vessel, and then they are going to interact. These yellow colors are the host lymphoid cells. These are your host lymphoid cells. So they are going to interact with the, these tumor cells are going to interact with the host tumor cells, and these tumor cells are very clever. They are very clever, and they are going to dodge them. And by dodging them, they are going to form the tumor cell emboli. Here you can see, this is the tumor cell emboli, and along with that tumor cell emboli, it is coated with the platelets, and so it is going to dodge the host immunity. And we are going to discuss in our later chapters how these tumor cells are capable enough for dodging the host lymphoid cells, and what is the role of the carcinogenic agents and the molecular bases, and what are their molecular bases of these things. So once they are going to form the emboli, these are going to extravasate at the site where they want to go. So they are going to go at the secondary metastatic site, and here there will be the extravasation, or these cells are going out of the vessels, and then they are going to cause the metastatic deposit at some place. And then because they are newly grown, they need for their clonal expansion and growth, and for the diversification, they need vessels, they need I have already told you oxygen, they need food. So again, by the help of the VEGF and the other factors, there will be the angiogenesis, and so there will be the growth of the transformed or the clonal expansion of the tumorous cells. So from here, which is your first site, we have already seen this thing, that from your first site, as I can draw this, from your this first site, this is your first site or the primary site. The tumors are going into the vessels after the invading into the extracellular matrix, and then they are going toward the second site, and this is the metastatic site. So I hope so. We will try to make it more easy. First of all, if you see, this is your primary tumor. There is a vascularization of this primary tumor, and here you can see what I was telling you. There is a detachment of these tumor cells. This detachment is by the E-cadherin, loss of the E-cadherin. So after the loss, there will be the extravasation and the intravasation of the tumor cells into the blood vessels, and then these are going to circulate like any tumor emboli. And when they are going to go at their distant site and the site they want to go or they have desires to go, they are going to cause the extravasation. And then the most important thing is going to come, and that is the growth of the secondary tumor at the because of the metastasis. So because of the metastasis, there will be the growth at the metastatic end, and this is the whole metastatic cascade. So I hope you will be able to understand this. Now we are going to discuss one by one the each step and which things are required during this each step. The invasion of the extracellular matrix is going to be achieved by two types, because you know there are two types of the extracellular matrix. One is the basement membrane and the other one is the interstitial connective tissue. So they are organized differently. Each of these have different components of the collagen, glycoproteins and the proteoglycans. So they need different things to be broken down. As you can all see, this invasion of the extracellular matrix is an active process. Here, this is very active process. Tumor cell is very tired now. You can see here. First, there is a detachment of the tumor cells from each other. Then there is a degradation of the extracellular matrix. Then there will be attachment to the extracellular matrix components. And the last one is the migration of the tumor cell. The first step is the loosening of the tumor cells. As I have told you, that the connections between these tumor cells will be lost. And the most important thing, that these tumor cells are going to lose the gel-like structure that is going to be called as E-cadherin. This E-cadherin is an intracellular glue, and this is going to bind with the beta-catenin, and beta-catenin and this E-cadherin is going to help in the making the cells to live together. So each adenosine function is basically lost in all the epithelial cancers. So my dear student, what are these epithelial cancers? These are going to be called as carcinomas. Just remember this thing, okay? Epithelial tumors are carcinomas. So mutational, and it is by the two things: mutational inactivation of the E cadherin. As you know, the E cadherin is going to glue the cells together, or by the activation of the beta catenin. And if the beta catenin is going to be activated, it is going to lose the E cadherin, and so there will be the loosening of the tumor cells. I'm going to tell you in this diagram. If you can see here, this is the E cadherin, this is the E cadherin, and this E cadherin is binded with the beta catenin. And these beta catenins have a complex which is going to be called as destruction complex. And along with this beta catenin, we have APC, adenomatous polyposis coli molecules, and these are binding the beta catenin. So once there are any signals coming outside from these cells, and like the WNT beta signaling pathways, and these are giving the signals for the cellular proliferation, what is going to happen? This E cadherin and the beta catenin relationship will be lost, and this is going to give the signal. So beta catenin will be released, and all the process of transcription or the translation will be started. So after there is a losing of the E cadherin from the beta catenin, there will be the loosening and the proliferation will be started. So what is going to happen in a malignant cell? This is the malignant cell. As you can see, no signal is coming at the upper surface. There is no signal. So why this all thing is happening? If you, my dear students, see this, this adenomatous polyposis coli is inactivated, or E cadherin is inactivated. Because of this, this beta catenin will be overactivated or hyperactivated, and this is going to cause the process of transcription and the translation. So the cell will lose their gluing part. And once they are going to lose their gluing part, they are going to separate from each other. And after getting separate from each other, they are going to go for the proliferation. So this will be the first step in the clonal proliferation of the tumorous cell. So the second step is the, I have already told you, once there is a detachment from the cells, there will be the local degradation of the basement membrane. And the second most important thing is the interstitial connective tissue. And how they are going to do this? They are going to do this in two methods. One, they are going to secrete the proteolytic enzymes. And my dear students, just remember these things. All the things that come with the ASEs are the proteolytic enzymes, like proteases. Or they are going to induce tumor cells. As you I just want you to remember the chapter of healing and repair, and you can just remember that the fibroblasts and inflammatory cells like neutrophils and other things are going to elaborate the proteases. So this is the second thing. One is they are going to secrete these proteolytic enzyme, and the second one is they are going to cause the induction of the stromal cells and the inflammatory cells, which are going to cause the release of the proteases. And as you all remember from your previous knowledge, that the most important thing is in the basement membrane degradation is the matrix metalloproteinases, cathepsin D, urokinases. Matrix metalloproteinases are going to cleave the type 4 collagen of the epithelial and the vascular basement membrane. So these are going to play an important role in the, when they are going to cause the intravasation. So when the tumor cells are going within the vessels, this MMP9 is going to play an important role. So malignant cells are going to overexpress this matrix metalloproteinase, and the level of the metalloproteinases inhibitors. So the things that are going to inhibit the MMPs will be reduced. So inhibitors will be reduced and the matrix metalloproteinases are going to cause the further degradation. So balance is shifted towards the tissue degradation. So there is a diagrammatic representation. So you can remember this again and again. So there is a loosening. Here you can see the cells are not very good together. So there is a loss of the E-cadherin. Whenever there is a loss of the E-cadherin, here you can see between in these two cells, there is a loss of the E-cadherin and they are moving away from each other. While in the other cells, if you are going to see here, these cells are very much distant and in very close contact to each other because the E-cadherin is still there. But here, there is no E-cadherin, so they are moving away from the each other or there is a detachment from the each other. So, I have told you there will be two things. One is these cells are going to secrete collagenases or ACEs by themselves and they are going to cause the activation of the plasminogen activator. So once there will be the plasminogen activator and the collagenases, this collagen type 4 is going to be cleavage. There will be the cleavage of the type 4 collagen. So the third step is the invasion involves the changes in the attachment of the tumor cells to the ECM proteins. Once there is a cleavage of the basement membrane proteins, collagen type 4 and the laminin by the matrix metalloproteinases and the MMP9, as I already told you that this MMP9 is going to cleave the collagen 4 and MMP2 is also going to do the same cleavage of the collagen 4 and the laminin. These are going to generate the novel site for these tumor cells to bind to the ECM and further causing the migration. So whenever there is a degradation by the MMP9 or the MMP2, there will be the opening up of the novel site so that these tumor cells can attach with these sites and they are going to cause the migration. So the carcinoma cells are going to have more receptors distributed all over their cell membrane, if you can see. So they need more integrins, and the selectins to bind to the ECM matrix and later on to the vessel wall. So the fourth step is the locomotion. This is the final step of the invasion and this is going to propel the tumor cell through the degraded basement membrane and the matrix proteolysis, and this is a very complex multi-step and is going to involve, as I already told you, there are many receptors which are also present on the tumor cells and the signaling proteins which are going to cause the activation and the locomotion of these cells through the actin cytoskeleton. These movements are to be potentiated and directed by many things. The most important things are the tumor cell derived cytokines. Like these tumor cells are going to secrete the autocrine motility factor. So these tumor cells are very, very clever cells. So these tumor cells are first, they have degraded the basement membrane. After degradation of the basement membrane by the MMP9 and the MMP2, then they are going to secrete the autocrine motility factor. So autocrine motility factor is help them to go further into the basement membrane and also into the actin cytoskeleton. Then there will be the cleave products of the matrix components, like of the matrix components, and they are going to help in the movement. Then there will be the growth factors, and these are going to cause the chemotactic activity for these tumor cells. And the most important ones are insulin-like growth factors and hepatocyte-like growth factors. These tumor cells, then these are all the things that are going to be caused by the tumor cells by themselves. Then there is the role of the stromal cells. So these promoters are also going to produce the paracrine effectors of all the cell motility factors, like I already do, hepatocyte growth factor or scatter factor, and these are going to bind to the receptors on these tumor cells. And I've already told you this, these tumor cells are very rich in the receptors, so these are going to bind with these HGF, hepatocyte growth factors, or the scatter factor are going to bind, and they are going to cause the motility or the locomotion. So here you can see, this is the detached cell. This has already invaded the basement membrane by the MMP2 and the MMP9, and then it is attacked by the fibronectin, and this is secreting the autocrine motility factor. And along with the autocrine motility factor, these stromal cells are also secreting insulin growth factor, hepatocyte growth factors, and these are going to cause the further motility towards the actin cytoskeleton. So now comes the second most important step, and this is the vascular dissemination and homing of the tumor cells. In the bloodstream, some tumor cells from the emboli, as I have already shown you in the diagram, that once they are in the vessel, they are going to form the emboli. So these are going to be called as tumorous emboli, and these are going to be surrounded by the platelets. Here the platelets are surrounding them, and these are the aggregated tumor cells, and they are going to give them the protections from the anti-tumor host effector cells. As I already wrote that these cells are very clever, so the host cells are not going to identify because they are forming the emboli, and these emboli are coated with the platelets and the circulating leukocyte. So whenever this tumor emboli feels like that this is my next home and here I have to reside for the life, then there will be the extravasation of the free tumor cells or the tumor emboli, and then there will be they have to adhere to the vessel wall, and then they are going to cause the extravasation, followed by the egress through the basement membrane into the organ parenchyma by the similar mechanism that I have already told you, is by the MMPs, matrix metalloproteinases, urokinases, cathepsinases, and then there will be the homing at the metastatic site. So again, if there is any confusion, I am going to repeat this diagram. Once there is a clonal expansion of the tumorous cells, these clonal expansion of the tumorous cells are going to go for the diversification and the angiogenesis, and this metastatic subclone is going to go for the separation in between these cells, and this is going to be achieved by the loss of the E-cadherin or by the activation of the beta-catenin, as I have already shown you in the diagram, and then this is going to invade the basement membrane and the ECM matrix. So ECM matrix, and this is going to be achieved by the matrix metalloproteinases, by the urokinases, by the cathepsinases, and then there will be the intravasation. After the intravasation, there will be the formation of the tumor cell emboli, and then there will be the host cells are coming, but they are not going to identify because they are being attached with the platelets and the leukocytes on the tumor emboli, and then there will be the extravasation into the metastatic site, and on this extravasation, then again there will be the angiogenesis for the further growth and the clonal expansion. So the site of the extravasation and the organ distribution of the metastasis generally predict by the location of the primary tumor and its vascular or lymphatic drainage. Wherever there is a vascular or lymphatic drainage, there will be the first site that the tumor cells are going to go there. In many of the cases, the natural pathway of the drainage do not readily explain the distribution of the metastasis. So it is very, very interesting thing to see that they are not following their normal pathway. So tumors from the lung cancer are going to involve the adrenals with some irregularity, but almost never going to spread to the skeletal muscles, which are living very close by it. So there is some very suspicious thing is going on here, and this is called as organ tropism. What is going to be called as organ tropism? So liver, in the liver, as I have already told you, bomb the blood from all the organs. The metastasis is coming from the skin. Here you can see skin, breast. They are also coming to the liver, from the lungs, from the esophagus, from the ovaries and the kidneys, and then from the gastrointestinal tract like colon, pancreas, rectum and the stomach. Here you can see that this is the primary site. This is the primary site. Here there is a tumor in the lung. So it could be a bronchogenic carcinoma. And this is going to invade by the vessel. These are your cancer cells, and these are going and they are going to reside into the second metastatic site, that is the liver. Here, yeah, I'm going to give you another examples. These are your naughty looking, very criminal looking cancer cells, and these cancer cells are going to be attached to the ECM matrix by the integrins, and they're going to secrete the autocrine motility factors, or the stromal cell are going to secrete the hepatocyte growth factor or the scatter factor, which are going to call the intravasation into the endothelium. And once they are going into the endothelium, here you can see from the microvasculature they are going into the bone. So just remember this thing: from the prostate, the metastasis into the bony areas and into the spine is very, very common thing, and they are going to reside there, and they are going to cause the focal proliferation of the prostatic carcinoma within the bone, and this is the its metastatic site. So what I have told you, that there is an organ tropism. There is a likening of these tumor cells to go to specific organs, and this is basically related to the expression of the ADN molecules that these tumor cells are showing, and these ligands are expressed on the endothelium of these target cells. So very easy, these tumor cells are going to show you the expression of the ADN molecules, and these ADN molecules ligands, I am going to draw for you people that the ligand for these things are there at the metastatic site. So because of this vasculature of the metastatic site, because of this thing, they are go towards these organ or towards this metastatic site. So another mechanism is the site-specific homing, which is going to involve the chemokines and their receptors. So my dear students, the question that you are going to ask in your university question is, write down the cascade of the metastasis. So you have to draw this whole diagram. First is the development of the primary tumor, or what I'm going to tell, I was telling you that there is a clone of the primary tumor cells that they are going to develop, and we are going to discuss in our next lectures about the oncogenes. These are the genes which are involved in the tumor causation and the tumor suppressor genes. As at the first slide I have told you that there should be some checkpoints in the cell cycle, like RB, like p53, and they are very important role in the development of these tumor cells, and we are going to discuss in our next lecture how they are going to proceed and how there will be the mutations in these tumor suppressor genes and how proto-oncogenes becomes oncogenes. So first there is a development of the primary tumor cells, then there will be the neovascularization, and I have already told you the most important thing is fibroblast growth factor or the vascular endothelial growth factor. Along with that, we are also having angiopontins or hepatocyte growth factor. After this, there will be the cell detachment, and because of this cell detachment, we need E-cadherin, as I've already told you. And after this E detachment, and there will be the invasion, and for this invasion, we need proteases like matrix metalloproteinases 2 and 9, and then we need for the locomotion motility factor. And the most important motility factor are going to be secreted by the tumor itself or by the stromal cell, like hepatocyte growth factors, like insulin growth factors, and the autocrine motility factor by the tumor itself. Once it will be done, then there will be the intravasation within the blood vessels. Here you can see there is an intravasation into the blood vessels, and this is going to be achieved by the ADN molecule. First, there will be the attachment within the blood vessels by the ICAM, VCAMs and the integrins, which are being expressed on the tumor cells, and they're going to bind by the endothelial cells, and then there will be the arrest and the adherence to the vessel wall, and these are going to cause the extravasation. And for the extravasation, the cells are going out, so they again need the ACEs to cause the degradation. So we are again having the matrix metalloproteinases, MMPs2s, and again the motility factors which are there, and then they are going to cause the micrometastasis at the secondary site. And for this, they need the growth factors, and for these growth factors, they are having the growth factor receptors, and then there will be the vascular neovascularization. And for this neovascularization, we need fibroblast growth factors, we need angiogenic growth factors, we need vascular endothelial growth factors, and then this is going to spread. Here you can see that it is spreading into the lungs, into the liver, and into the bone. So this is, my dear student, this is your whole cascade. Now I'm going to give you an MCQ. The biopsies were performed. I have already asked you this question. I'm again telling you, please do this question. Now it will be very easy for you to do this. And this is your SCQ. A 60-year-old woman is diagnosed with an ovarian cancer. Just remember this thing. The tumor is found to be unresectable. On laparotomy, the peritoneal cavity contains excessive fluid that on cytological examination shows malignant cell. We have already talked about pseudomyxoma peritoni. I've shown you the pictures of the pseudomyxoma peritoni. So the question that is being asked from you people is, describe the process by which tumor cells have reached the peritoneal cavity. So you are going to tell me or draw the whole cascade of this. And please give it, answers should be given on my email. And if you are unable to do the email, you can send me on the WhatsApp, or MCQ answer should be sent along with the attendance. Okay? So you have, the second part is you have to give me the differences between the sarcoma and the carcinoma. I have told you many times that the sarcomas are the mesenchymal tumors and the carcinomas are the epithelial tumors. And the most important thing about the sarcomas and the carcinomas is the difference in between the their spread of the tumors. I have already told you that the carcinomas are going to spread by the vessel, by the lymphatics, and the sarcomas are going to spread by the blood vessels. So this is your assignment. You just have to do this. You have to draw the cascade and send it to me. Wish you very best of luck. I hope this lecture is very much interesting for all of you. Thank you very much for listening, and thank you very much for your patience.